Right, without further ado, let's bring him in from Evansville, Indiana. That's his birthplace anyway. Now resides in Florida, two-time Super Bowl champion, six-time Pro Bowler, and he did play on that undefeated 1972 Miami Dolphins team. My childhood hero, Bob Griese. Hey, Bob, how are you?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Good to catch up with you. I'm looking forward to talking a little football with you. You know, let's go back to the days of the Miami Dolphins and that undefeated season. So much has happened since then. What do you still remember that really stuck out about that season? And did you feel at some point that, hey, we're going to do this. We're going to be the only undefeated team in the history of the NFL?
You know, what sticks out, what I remember most is losing the Super Bowl the year before. And Coach Shula, right after we lost to the Cowboys in Super Bowl VI, right after that game in the locker room, he said, we're going to have to, next year we're going to have to play hard and win just to get back to where we were right before we played the Super Bowl game number 6 against the Cowboys.
Uh-huh.
So we started out winning, and we played some tough teams. We beat Minnesota up there, and they did the Jets with Namath, and so there was no plan to go undefeated. Mm. We didn't talk about it. We didn't, you just kept winning, and we said, well, all right, back then, it was decided ahead of time where you would play the playoff games. It wasn't who had the best record.
Mm.
It was, so we had to go. So we were, we were like 14-0, and we had to go to Pittsburgh to play the AFC Championship game to go to the Super Bowl.
Wow.
So, anyway, no, there was no talk about going undefeated. It was just, let's get back to the Super Bowl. After we won the game, after we won the Super Bowl, and we were 17-0, there was no big deal. It says, we didn't celebrate and say, we went undefeated. We celebrate and say, hey, we finally won the Super Bowl, and there's no more games to play next week.
Now, Bob, it's become part of the football landscape that when a contemporary football team gets deeper and deeper into the season with an unbeaten record, there are Dolphins from that team who toast the loss of the team that now has lost the game, and therefore your record stays intact.
Sure.
Are you one of those toasters, or do you not care whether somebody is unbeaten going forward?
They used to say that we all would get together and toast with champagne and all that other stuff. You mentioned I'm from Evansville, Indiana. I'm a small town kid. I'll have a beer maybe, mm-hmm. but I'm not having any champagne.
But do you root for the unbeaten team of today to lose, or do you care one way or the other?
Well, yes and no. Yes, I would like, you always want to be the only one that did something, but no, in the sense that if the New England Patriots, for instance, go undefeated, I'll call Tom Brady and congratulate him and say, welcome to the mountaintop of being undefeated in the NFL,
Mm-hmm. Good for you.
Now, Bob, Larry Zonka is a player who played right here in Syracuse. It's a name that's very familiar to Central New Yorkers. He was on those teams that you played on. Tell us a little bit about what he was like back in the day.
Oh boy, he was. We were a team that our offensive line was better at run blocking than they were at pass protection. Zonka, Kick, and Mercury Morris were three running backs, and two of those guys couldn't catch the ball very well. And I'm talking about the boy from Syracuse, Zonka, and Mercury Morris. They couldn't catch very well. Jim Kick now could catch, run, and block.
Yeah.
We were better at controlling the clock, controlling the ball, staying on the field, keeping our defense off the field, and going down and scoring touchdowns. And Zonka, he was tough. He was a tough. he was a tough guy. we were in the Super Bowl. We were in the third Super Bowl, and I drove. We drove all the way down in the opening drive. We were playing the Minnesota Vikings in Super Bowl VIII, and I turn around and we get on the. We were on about the 3 yard line, and I forgot. And I told the guys in the huddle. I said, "Be alert now. We may have to check off. Because they use two different types of goal line defenses." Mm-hmm. So I called the play that I thought that they were going to be the defense. I wouldn't have to check. So I said, "Be alert, I'm at the check." I said, "All right, Brown left near close, 18 straight, on one, ready, break." So I go up the line of scrimmage, and I'm thinking what I'm going to check to if they're in the other defense. It's not good for that play.
Right.
So I get up there, and the line gets down, and I see that they're good for the play that I've got called. But in doing all this gymnastics, I'd forgotten the snap count. You know, and that happens occasionally.
Sure.
So I turn around and zonk. I turn around real casually. In the Super Bowl on the 4 yard line, the opening drive, as casual as me. And I said, "Zonk, what's it on?" Zonk had his head down, counting the blades of grass in the artificial turf. You know, when everybody moves, he moved. So he raised his head and said, "It's on two." Well, that was bad information because it was on one. But then Jim Kicks lined up right next to him and said, "Zonk, it's on one." Zonk looked over at him. He was a dominant guy, you know. "It's on two." Well, now all my offensive linemen are tied in. Their heads are turning and wondering, what's it on? What's it on? Well, the ball was snapped. I said, I ain't got much time to get this ball off here. So I said, "Seth, 380, 380, hut." And the ball came up on one. Nobody else moved. Our whole team moved. And the Vikings, their defensive line didn't move. They thought they heard all that conversation. They thought it was on two also.
That's awesome.
So anyway, but Zonk was a tough guy and was the heart and soul of that team.
Outstanding. Hey, when the Dolphins, and you know, I hate to, I mean, you're famous for being 17-0. So when you, as the quarterback of that club, quarterback of a perfect team in terms of record, when you see other teams taking runs at perfection, and most particularly just the other day, when you see the Golden State Warriors could have gone 16-0 in these playoffs, I don't know if you're much of an NBA fan, but the Warriors are really good and they're darn near perfect. Do you have any sense of identity or any sense of fanhood, or do you not even see any connective tissue there?
No, I watched the NBA, and I was aware of that, and I said, okay, because I remember how difficult it was to go undefeated. Coach Shula has often said that, you know, you got to be ready to play each and every week, and you have to be good every week, and that's what the Warriors had been. They were tough in the first round, and they were tough in the second round. But it's you know, I was kind of pulling for them because, you know, welcome to the group. We know, because now when they talk about the Warriors going undefeated, they would mention the Dolphins. Mm-hmm. But it's just something that's not that easy to do, and you know. We thought, right after we did it, right after we went undefeated, we didn't think it was such a big deal because we thought, all right, you know, Bradshaw and the Pittsburgh Steelers, they won 4 Super Bowls in the 70s. We thought, you know, they would, you know, they'll go undefeated. Well, then they didn't go undefeated. Then you had the Cowboys, and you have Montana and San Francisco, and then you have all of these teams that go through, and then Brady, they did go undefeated during the regular season. But it just goes to show you how difficult it is. You got to be ready to play every week, and you got to be lucky sometimes. But we didn't talk about going undefeated. Like I said, you know, we talked about, you know, just winning the thing.
Talking with legendary quarterback Bob Griese on the Bud of the Manchild program this morning. Bob, you played for Don Shula. Marty's the greatest coach in the NFL. The contemporary fan might argue that Belichick is the best coach in the NFL. In your mind, who's the best coach?
Well, you know, I vote for Coach Shula. the Dolphins came into existence in 66. I was a first-round draft pick out of Purdue in 67. So I came there, and we lost. We were a losing team. My first 4 years, 67, 68, and 69, we lost. And Coach Shula came in 1970. Our record before he came, the season before he came, was 3-10-1. He came in 1970. Our record was 10-4. We made the playoffs. We didn't go to the Super Bowl, but we went to the Super Bowl in 71, the second year he was there, and we lost. 3 of the first 4 years that Coach Shula was there, we went to the Super Bowl. We won it twice, and we were undefeated one time. What an impact he made on that team. It was a losing team. It was a new franchise in 66, and he comes in 70, and we win the Super Bowl in his second year.
Was he the great detail guy? Was he the great motivator? What is it that made him stand out?
He was everything.
Okay.
You know, we had two fields, and then the offense would be practiced on one field, and the defense would be practiced on the other field. And if it's defensive day on Thursday was defensive day, he'd be over there on the defense. But in between defensive plays, he'd look over, you know, what was about 75, 80 yards across to the other field. And if I would hand the ball off and not run down the field with the team, or if I threw a poor throw, I could hear this voice: "Come on, Griese, get that ball over there. You got to throw that ball quicker than that." He knew everything that was going on. But the thing about it was, everything that he brought to that team in 1970. There was a strike that first year, and so he was chomping at the bit to get with his team and put in the new terminology. There were no off-season conditioning programs and OTAs and mini camps and that.
Right.
The first time he saw his guys when they came in August, late July, because back then we played 6 preseason games. But anyway, he was chomping at the bit, and when we finally did get to camp, we practiced 4 times a day, and we saw that there was some good coming from these. There was walkthroughs, and all the players. This wasn't a thing that he was punishing us for striking. This was something that we were getting some good from practicing 4 times a day, and that's where it all started. The respect right there for Coach Shula.
Bob Griese on with Bud and the Manchild this morning. Bob, we have this wonderful young lady who's come to intern for us this year from Florida Atlantic. She's got some roots here in Central New York, and since she went through the trouble of helping corral you, we're going to let her throw a question at you. She says she's got a good question for you. Let's see what Courtney throws at you. Go ahead, Court.
Well, there's been a lot in recent media about, you know, the older NFL teams are kind of showing up with these injuries now that are showing up. And so I just wanted to know, like, do you think the NFL has been taking these, like, good steps or proactive steps at protecting their players now more so than they did before?
Well, I think both, that's a good question. I think both the pros, the NFL, and the college, the NCAA, are taking steps to protect the players. The helmets, back when we played, weren't that good. Now they're getting better and better and better. The equipment, the tackling, the hitting. You'll see if a wide receiver in college runs a square in 20 yards over the middle of the field, and the free safety comes up and hits him with a forearm above the shoulder pads and hits him in the head, immediately the officials go and look at, they call it, what do they call it? Targeting.
Right.
That's what they call it. They call it targeting. And if they see that he was aiming for his head, they can kick him out of the game. They can disqualify him.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that's being done. And in the NFL, if that same play occurs, they won't kick the guy out the first time, but if he has another one in that game, they're going to kick him out. So what I'm saying is they're taking notice of protecting players. You can't hit the quarterback above the shoulder pads or below the knees in the pocket. So, yeah, there's a lot being done to try and protect the players.